Chazen, it's my privilege to welcome you to this evening's lecture. And it's a delight to really have this lecture here again with a dear old friend. Ever since she received her MFA from Yale University in 1973, Judy Pfaff has challenged and delighted audiences with her irreverent and idiosyncratic work. Although primarily a sculptor, Judy is a master of all media. She originally trained as a painter and progressed to sculpture, printmaking, and installation art. One thing I would say, she's also a wonderful draftsperson. Her drawings are something to die for. And I think if any students are in the hall who are looking for a doctoral dissertation, her drawing is a place to look at very seriously. Judy is also an outstanding teacher. She has served as the Richard B. Fisher Professor in the Arts and Director of the Studio Art Program at Bard College in New York for many years. She is revered for her very special talent for communicating and inspiring her students. There are many people who've been inspired throughout the country whose work stems from her. And again, that is another topic, I think, of discussion. I think her influence on the arts, especially in the United States, is going to be very, very profound and very broad. Her work has been the subject of numerous scholarly publications, including the monograph that the Elvian produced in conjunction with Hudson Hills Press in 2003, and she has been the recipient of numerous awards, including a MacArthur Fellowship in 2004. And of those of you who may not be familiar with the MacArthur Fellowship, it's otherwise known as the Genius Award, and I think it was truly merited. Judy has had numerous exhibitions throughout the world. Her work has always been received with great critical acclaim. The exhibition that many of us will remember here in Madison is the installation in Page Court called If I Had a Boat, which was presented from September 2000 through July 2001. And the exhibition that accompanied it in 2000 and also in 2001, which put the installation in a broader context. I've never forget the day that Judy first arrived for the installation with her truck and her crew. And one of the first things that she unpacked was her barbecue. And I looked and I said, Judy, what are you going to do with that? She said, you're going to have a crew here that's going to work on this piece, and I'm going to have to feed them. And doggone it, she gave some of the best barbecues outside of the Albion that we've ever attended. Judy's first residency at Tandem Press was in February 1996. And in spite of the winters, she has been coming back ever since. We, of course, are delighted to have her here. A small selection of her print work is currently on view in the exhibition upstairs called Tandem Press Highlights 1995 to 2005. Judy has graciously agreed to do a book signing at the conclusion of this lecture, which will take place upstairs just outside of the museum shop. The title of her lecture tonight is 2D to 3D Printmaking and Sculpture, and I can't think of a person more qualified to talk on this topic. Please welcome a wonderfully creative artist, marvelous person, and a dear friend. Judy?
That was pretty good. Now, genius won't seem quite as curious to you, because we've got to redefine what that sort of means. Anyway, did you know that it is Russell's birthday? So there's some good news and some bad news. The bad news is I have a lot of slides, but the good news is I'm very fast, so I get him home so he can celebrate. I came to Madison unwittingly. I think I was invited in January, and all I could think of was, I'm going to Wisconsin, or actually I thought it was Minnesota. So, you know, and it was a slow beginning. It really was. I think I'm someone you have to get used to, because I bring things like barbecues, thinking that has high priority. So I'll show you a lot of slides from about 30 years of work, but I will go through them quickly. I did study at Yale. Al Held was my teacher. He has painting upstairs. And I think if you look at that painting, and if you remember, if you saw the piece that I did here, there actually is enormous relationships between the two of us.
I have
Yeah, I was a photographer, a painter. Thank you very much. And there was something very curious about being a painter that I didn't realize, is that all the faculty wanted to talk about you in relationship to the past. So the paintings never seemed to be looked at particularly. Al was a little bit different. He didn't really care. He just kept being very provocative and asking what everything meant. So after a while, you tried to get him out of the studio too. because you really sort of didn't know. But he was very, very invested in the conversation and the dialogue. I didn't make a painting after my first month at Yale, even though I was in the painting department. So this is a few years after. This is in the Neuberger Museum. It's an installation. I think you can see many, many parts. It was, and everything has always been basically a narrative, whether you kind of get it or you don't get it. Every image here actually represented someone I knew or something that I was smitten with, and usually connected with art and art history. So there's a lot of sort of personal stuff going on, but it's codified. Now, I was at war against the male sculptor, just because it was an easy target. They usually made, at that time, minimal things, usually brown, usually heavy, and opaque. So coming from painting, I decided it could be colorful, it could be illusionistic, it could be transparent, it could sprawl. It never had a center. And that's probably true still. So I will go through these. This is my first digital performance. And Jason, who is hopefully is here if something goes wrong, helped me put this together. So you'll see some things which are like scanned. I know a lot about what can go wrong. So anyway, but this is the same time you can sort of see this imagery. This was Richard Archfager. Just to give you a clue on our relationship. There you go. This is the drawing. So, and I made many, many of these. I tend to, once I get started, they just sort of like spill out. So there are probably, I don't know, maybe 50 to 100 of these trying to. I thought I was being like a little computer, so I would go like up over. So I didn't have a computer. I'm fascinated with technology, don't know a thing about it. So this was my sort of etch-a-sketch, sort of. Again, this sort of coding. I think you can see there's like figures in here, the upside down feet, the feet, heads upside down. So I would work out all of these things which ultimately became these sculptures. This show is called Charms, and it was in Houston, Texas, and I decided not to do any more figures. I'd had it. Things were sort of, I learned how to weld and to do some joinery, but there was something about the imagery that I didn't need anymore, meaning I was working out relationships in the early figure studies. This, because it's called Charms in Relationship to Energy, and there's these subatomic particles called charms and quarks and things like that. So mostly it was about a kind of spinning and a kind of openness. I just turned it off. That's what that means. It's off. And after that, I went to the Yucatan, and it gave me an image bank to work from for a very long time, actually. This was called Kabuki. It was a little stage. It was in Washington, D.C. And mostly what you're seeing is actually you're seeing through things. There's a lot of paint on the walls. This thing called installation was that I would bring stuff in. I would have a set amount of time. It was like beat the clock. And I would do this and walk away. With each and every one of these, there is a story. For instance, this one, most of the stuff that I was bringing to Washington, D.C. fell off the truck in a snowstorm between New York and Washington. That evening I saw a Kurosawa film because I was devastated, and I decided to do a Japanese-style kakemusha thing. So working in that kind of ad hoc, ad lib, and sort of instantaneous way has its good sides. This is in the Whitney. Probably about 3 months later, it was called Dragon. At this moment, it's about 79-80, there was a lot of interest in this kind of working process, I guess. I'm going to run through these. Each one of these are pretty big, room size. So whatever, it's like a goldfish that you put in a bowl, and if you put it in a big bowl, it gets bigger. So they give me the space, I will fill it. This is at the Venice Biennale. It's called Eat a War. I thought it was very Italian. Usually, there's a lot of sort of homage to the place that I'm in. These are details. You're looking for about 60 linear feet of space. There's a kind of smashing that happens in the slot. These are the drawings. So this drawing is 14 feet long. And I came to Yale with 200 pounds of glitter. That was one of the big arguments Al and I had. He thought it was an incredibly unremarkable product to use to make any artwork. So, but I think you can see in this, there's a lot of this overlay imagery, a lot of water sort of imagery, a lot of transparency, and a lot of stuff. This is a little bit later. This is at the Albright Knox. This was an homage to the entire collection of the Albright Knox. I don't know if you know, it's really an amazing collection of American abstract expressionism. I think this is my American Stuart Davis. I moved to Brooklyn. I became very involved with Brooklyn. And the neighborhood stores and the signage. So it was in the Whitney in 87. Okay. Side view. I don't know if you can see this, but this is a Jeff Koons bunny. And this is the first, there was a basketball thing, a recruiter which said, I shot, therefore I am. Over here, which was gigantic, of a screaming rhesus monkey. So this, as big as it was like, fell on deaf ears. It was like not the moment for this kind of stuff, you know. Anyway. These are the drawings. This is underneath the Brooklyn Bridge. This is in Japan. This is, a really nice piece. And I think you can tell there's a lot of aspects of the Japanese culture in this. There's even language in it. There's things that say river and stream and things like that. And there's a lot of woodcut. There's a lot of ikebana sort of stuff. This was unrecognizable to the Japanese. They thought it was unbelievably un-Japanese. So much for my communication skills. It went up 30 feet tall. And this, the space is a little bit like the Guggenheim atrium space. This is the work directly after coming back from Japan. My gallery, Holly Solomon, was a great, great gallery. Moved uptown, and I couldn't think of what to put in there. So I decided that artists make either, it used to be portraits, landscapes, still lives. So these were the still lives. Like the only thing I could figure out how to fit in the place. It was called Apples and Oranges. And there are moments, like at this moment, I decided colors sucked. I was in love with glass blowers and their transparent orbs, whatever that means. And so this is a print. And this is the imagery that is probably directly related to these kinds of things. So I think you can tell it's not, they're never one-on-one, but there are obviously relationships. earthier, more nature-oriented, very low color, a little more cosmic. The thing I like about this one is I got to tear out the roof of this institution. I'm not sure they thought that was good. It displaced all the air. You know, the HVAC was like going nuts. This is in Columbus, Ohio, in the middle of winter. But it was really beautiful because I thought it was very crystalline. And it had my, I taught at Ohio State in 1974, so my only memory of Ohio State was being cold and having a class full of Woody Hayes' football team. And it was a watercolor class. I taught watercolor to the football team. So actually, I decided we'd do a class on colored water, which was more interesting. This sort of zenny thing here is, I lived upstate, and I was lived upstate for a long time now. But I was dumbfounded how nothing happened. I lived on the river in a tugboat factory. So I think this, I didn't even realize at the time, but I think this whole sort of sensation in here was very, very calm by comparison.
Upstate of New York?
Yeah, Kingston, New York, the first capital of New York. It's very Dutch. It's a grim town, but it was great musicians, great writers, great artists now, because it was very cheap, and that's changed after 9/11, I guess, that thing. But it's actually a fabulous town. They're tearing down the old parts so fast, it makes your head spin. So I think you can get a sense of sort of the imagery. This was in Brazil. This is an odd one. It was just the prettiest gallery I ever saw. It had all these curves. And I think if you've seen a lot of my prints, I'll go back and forth from things which are very natural, very photographic, to these sort of abstract, sort of buoyant, sort of orby, spacey, optical things. The shape of this gallery was exactly, I thought, the shape of the eyeball. So I decided to make this very optical sensation about colors shifting, and it was more sublime than usual. This is right after 9/11. It was in Savannah, in Georgia. Savannah. And I decided to make something which was about restoration. I was also living in a Victorian house, and I was restoring it too. So every technique is really very old-fashioned. Impressions from tin ceilings, impressions from molding around the town. Savannah is a very old and beautiful, beautiful town. And so it was really, it was called Squares of Savannah, so you sort of walked this same shape. This was a little while ago. Funny corridor, very complicated. This fellow here is Jamie Hamilton, who was my assistant, who is probably the best welder I've ever seen. I now have, though, 6 or 7 welders. We have little ones, big ones, 3-phase, 2-phase, 110, MIGS, TIGS, oxyacetylene, you name it, we have that. But he is a great person, a great assistant. This was a show that opened a couple of years ago, actually, at my gallery. I show in New York very seldom. I think it's about every 6 years, because it terrifies me. Every time you show, they'll sort of, you never know how they're going to come at you. Now I'm this old-timer, so they're very soft, they're very gentle, so I get through much easier, I don't know. But anyway, I think you can see in the back there are drawings in another room back there. These are, the whole show had a survey sort of architectural motifs. Obligatory water lily. Jamie again. I'm taking the pictures, that's why. called Capella, actually. It was a little chapel for friends. I don't have great slides of the old name, sure. And actually, I always think it was much fuller than that looks. But if you walked it, by the way, there are very few institutions that would let you do what I did here. And that's Russell. And it's amazing. He's done shows, I think, who would allow artists to do that? But it was, it had a maze on the bottom. I think a lot of what drove this image was that I thought this was a very cold space, a lot of concrete. And I thought it needed some flowers. So it was going to be sort of this garden. And then it sort of became something else. What you can see are these spires are held by these walls down here, and only the children, when they move them, the whole thing shifted. So it was sort of suspended a little bit like that upside down drawing of Gaudi for the Sagrada Familia. Like that sort of aspect, only reversed and not as interesting. But anyway, installing. I think this gives you, this is a scan from the book actually, this gives you some sense of more, I think, more accurate the sensations. These are drawings. Studio. Messy. I think in here you can see there's photography. This is a tree in Brazil. These are ferns. They might be from Bill Weehee's garden. I think Bruce found me these hostelries. Bruce obtained them. Ah, Tandem. It took me so long. How many things did we have to make to pull something out of this? It was like mind-boggling. What happened was I had this unit size. It was this size, this unit. There were lots of them. I was trying to make one print. One single print. We had variations of this that went on and on and on, and I couldn't figure it out. That's normal for me, but that's very hard to have someone who's working for you who are used to sort of people going more directly to what they needed to do. In the meantime, Annette, one of the printers, Annette, had a baby, and this was Kaya. That's this. Now, this is Andy's foot. Annette's foot? No, or maybe that was Mark's foot, I don't know. Anyway, so her being pregnant, I knew what to do, because there were a lot of feet and hands going on. It was like, good, I know how to do it. So all of this came together, and I'm not lying to you, an hour before I left Tandem, and then I said to Paula, trust me, I'll make these work. And I don't know what she said. I think it was like, get on the plane. But she also did trust me. And I said, there's this other problem. I've got to frame all of these. Now, they were going to Chicago. And she had to trust that not only would I finish these things and not muck them up, but get them to Chicago. I'm running from Brooklyn to, I forget what gallery, had a truck leaving for Chicago. They were waiting for me deliver this stuff, and they were literally off the press. It was not easy. And when I left that first time, second time, or third time, I forget, I thought we'd never, now, they're like family now. So it all worked well. Drawings. And this is a set of photogravures. These are, you know, this is the digital age. Photogravures are really meant to be 8x10. I decided to do some which were, I don't know, a lot bigger than 8x10. So we had to bring in Lothar. Now, I think what's interesting about Tandem, many things, but it was also set up by Bill Weehee. So it has a manly presence. It has a Bill Weehee presence. He has a huge press and things that press. You know, that hydraulic thing. So scale mean nothing to me. That's like the goldfish thing. If I wanted to do a 10-foot or 12-foot print, I had the space to do it. And Paula I think, swallowed hard, but sort of let me do that. So there's a lot of reasons why things work. One, you like each other. Two, the atmosphere is conducive. And three, they leave you alone and trust that you will perform. It's a little bit like saying the check's in the mail. So there is a lot of trust that goes on. These are the photogravures. These, I think, have a real melancholy about them because I was stuck in Walla Walla for 7 months, dying in Walla Walla, wallowing in Walla Walla. And this is not the landscape of Walla Walla. It's in Portland, and it's very wet. It rained for, I think, 3 months. You know those things about Lewis and Clark? They're all true. There's also something going on here, which is something that I might do. One is of a wild situation, which is this one. This is completely natural one. And this one is a garden, a formal garden, Japanese garden in Portland. And so there's, even though they look strikingly similar, there's actually two different languages going on. I'm terrified of horses. I'm terrified. So I was looking to cut a tree down or have a tree cut down, and I was walking across this field and kind of came across these terrified horses. I was running, they were running, were standing, and but there was something, I guess I took a picture because I found this picture in my camera, so I did. The negatives are terrible. I am a terrible photographer. It's not really about that. It was that we work these things so much, and they're it's like pulling an image out of it, in spite of my bad technical knowledge. So I just sort of had to tell you that printmaking tends to be extremely technical, and it is. When I leave, the people who know what they're doing take over and correct things a lot. This spin around with the camera. It's actually in an Indian reserve. This was called The End of the Rain. It's a big print. These are all the trees outside when I was installing in Brazil. Handy. Big print. 10 feet. I think it's 10 feet. I think so. Mm. I play at the computer. That's a fake shot. I don't know anything. I think you can tell this is a collection of photo positives. It's all from Rome. All imagery from Rome. This was a set of prints, an edition of individual ones, similar. And Bruce came out. This is Bruce Crownover, of Tandem Press. He came out, and we worked in the attic in my Victorian house. I don't know how long.
A week or so.
A week or so. And I was complaining the entire time.
In a good way.
In a good way. See, I do work. Bruce gets me to, we escape. I think of things like, I think we need some fern, so then we have to go traveling. So we needed water lilies. So this is on Lake Mendota.
Yeah.
Yeah.
University Bay.
University Bay, can you believe that? Most of these are photogravures. This one is just, I needed an extra plate, so. You can see the water lilies are like a motif that really run through a lot of these. This is one of my favorite prints. There at the back of the plate is a stack of water lilies which were dried and adhered to the luon. And it sat around for a very long time, and a couple of years later I figured out how to resolve it. This is from my trip to Venice, Rome, This is a trip to my friend's house, Jane Rosen, who also prints at Tandem. Taken with my camera out of the side view going about 60 miles an hour. This was my studio, you can't see it here. This was my studio on the river, and this is just a trip to the lighthouse in my rubber boat. We're coming to an end. This is called Money Tree. And this actually has a funny story. Everything is a story. I really wanted this plant, and it was right across the street from Tandem Press, and this fellow, I don't remember his name. But I just wanted to steal it, which is what you do if you're from Brooklyn. No. And Bruce made me ask. We knocked on the door and asked. It's a plume poppy. And it's as tall as that is, so it's 6 feet tall. It's so beautiful, but what I like so much is like a lot of the stuff really comes from like across the street, down the, even if it looks exotic, it's really sort of homemade. And that's the way I like things to look, like a lot of them. Joe is missing. You have to put Joe, you have to put all the students. And I miss Amy. She's not here this week. So that's it. Thank you.
Judy.
Yeah, that was my. We did good. I know. They look good. They look good. That's Jason. Yeah. Yay.
Are there any questions for Judy?
For these larger scale installations,
yes.
Do you bring the material with you,
oh
or do you acquire them locally?
Both. It also depends on my fear level and the time schedule. For this show that was here, I wasn't really prepared. I also had lost my assistant, Dylan, who went to Walla Walla, stayed in Walla Walla, and now runs the Foundry, and has two children, bought a house. So it was a good thing, he went there. But I had no assistance, so I had to train. I had this lovely girl named Jess, who had been working for me for a month. And it was like being thrown into the fire. We bought a lot of extra steel. We brought a lot. I knew there was a maze on the bottom. I sort of knew it was going to be kind of a funny cathedral of sorts. But there's a lot that gets made and adjusted. And after a while you get a feeling for it, like what's so nice about Page Court is the skylight. So it just sort of, when I was thinking about the space, I really only saw the concrete, the travertine, hello, not concrete, travertine, just Italian travertine. And I had one thing, for all the permission I had, I couldn't drill into the travertine. And I didn't, did I? They made a mess of it, but I didn't drill into it. I bring a lot of material.
Is that a problem when you go internationally?
Sure is. I haven't been in Europe for 24 years, probably because of that. There's also nothing to sell. 90% of what you saw is destroyed.
Hi. Can you speak a little about moving from 3D to 2D? Are you frustrated when you have to hold to 2D and the prints?
I'm sort of a covetcher. So if I'm making sculpture, I think I should be making drawings, and if I'm making drawings, I think I should be doing sculpture. So there's a little bit of that. Once most my process, my working method is it starts so slowly, and by the end it really goes fast and it all makes sense and the rhythms are there. So once I'm in a drawing mode, like once I start doing printmaking or just drawing, it feels awkward at first because I don't know. Because I start from scratch again, you know, and you feel like you're really stupid and you don't know what you're doing and you're never going to, usually start where you left off. And you didn't even like that. So by the end, you're in a new phase. So I don't think something odd about it, and I used to think this, I used to teach printmaking, that there's something like little angels are in the press. Like you put something that's very rugged and nasty, and it comes out really nice. And I don't know what happens, you know? Like, and so it's all, and also I'm so dyslexic that everything is reversed. I don't even notice. People say, is that, it's like, I thought that's what I did, you know? So for me, it really works, the layering, the imagery, and now I don't know if you, well, you do know, because you know, but there's a lot of transparency. Even, you know, when you see any kind of image, it's just flat, and there's actually holes, burns, transparencies, and layers. And I really do like that. Plus, if I think of something truly tedious to do, there's someone who will do it for me. Which I really think is spectacular. You know, I mean, it's abusive, but.
Yes. You did a wonderful piece for the Madison Print Club, and there's.
That's what got this thing started. Yeah, that started the whole.
And I looked at it a million times, and I'm wondering, is it an Asian influence? Or
it sure is. I always thought I was Asian, except I'm not. And I just went to China, by the way. Yeah, it's very Asian. I think this is where it came from, a lot of it. A long time ago, when Al and I used to argue, and we went to Japan once because I did a print in Japan. And he kept saying, this is a culture of sticks and paper. And Rome is a culture of marble and da-da. And I thought, oh, and he said, here, everything is about an ensemble aesthetic. It's not the food, it's the food on the plate on the table, the flower on the table, the view through the window, and the mountain in back of the view, you know, like all of it. It's like, it's, so there's nothing to hold on to. So I always thought, well, I'm sort of Asian. You know. So a lot of that has that kind of spill through, that kind of non-centeredness, and not there's not a lot of ownership. Like there's not an object that you can sort of evaluate. Should be big or small. It's really experiential. Like when you go anywhere and you sort of see a view for the first time. I do think that's something with the installations, and most of the imagery, I wait for something to have a kind of energy in it. And I don't, it's a stupid word, but a kind of a nervousness. Sometimes it just has a vibration, a visual vibration, or a kind of way of passing through lots of things, so don't stop too much. It's a meander. Yeah. So I thought that it's very Asian. I'm making this up.
This may be mundane, but what happens to an installation after you leave it?
Lately, there's so much steel, and steel is so expensive. You think oil prices are bad? It's raw. It can be cut down enough that it's some raw material, but 90%. It's basic.
Do you ever recycle?
No, it's like car parts. You know, it's like you gotta, it's a muffler, or it's a hood, or it's a light bulb, but it's just not, doesn't fit, the scale is wrong. So things even, they never slid back and forth, no. And it used to make me, well, it was expensive to keep rebuying something you thought you bought, you know. So, very seldom. If it was neutral enough, then perhaps. But if it had any imagery in it.
As you create motifs and designs, are you at the same time thinking of the printmaking technique that you're going to be using?
No.
Do those
no.
coincide at all?
No. I don't think so. What do you think? No. Yeah.
Can you explain?
You know what's so funny about Bruce is he was in, like, there were times when you studied with an Asian master, right? So I think he had a calm. That he brought, that if I changed my mind, a lot of times, and also I think things will just, a couple of those really fast. One night it was like just cutting wood and it made sense. I really like thinking to get past what I came thinking I would do to get to what I, to be in the present is a very difficult thing. It is. And I think with the printmaking now.
Everything overlaps though.
It does. Yeah, I mean, it's your DNA. I mean, it's like, you know when you see a picture of a little kid, or you when you were a little kid, it's like, I know that I'm exactly the same. You recognize different parts of you. You didn't know, you were sort of more. You know what I mean? So yeah, that's why I sort of said in the first one, it's like all of those principles, the kind of layering, the scattering, the kind of complexity, it's always been a necessary ingredient for something. It's what I like to look at, what I understand.
If you start a print and you feel it's not working, you put it aside and come back to it, and what determines whether you come back to it? What happens in the interim?
I remember it. I'll be working on something and I'll think, wait a minute, you know, it's, where is that? And I'll say to Andy or to Joe, did we keep that? The good thing is they keep everything, you know, so if I do revisit it, it's there. Sometimes you're ahead of yourself. You're making something, you don't know what it's in relation to, and then you remember. So sometimes I'll think, where is that? Where is that play? Now I know what it is. Your second question.
Yeah, I was just curious. You showed an installation that had a lot of electrical insulators. I was wondering, was that supposed to represent a substation or something?
See, I don't even. There were? No. Must have just looked like that.
It looked like insulators, yeah.
Oh, no insulators. Uh-huh. I would like some insulators. Uh-huh. they used to have the glass ones, right? And they'll surround.
Right.
Yeah, the glass ones.
Those are collectibles.
No, usually it's not that different. And I don't know, I'm more romantic. Al used to say I don't really make images of where I've been, but what I think they are, what I imagine. They're more feminine. They're an image of something, and usually I stop doing that when I visit there. Or, you know, I mean, it's funny, when the real thing comes in, it's like, oh, I don't know. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Did you do smaller pieces of Savannah with the squares?
Yeah.
And then, so did you carry it into print painting, or?
There's a lot of imagery you'll see in some, I don't know if I showed them. There's a lot of lace, there's a lot of, imagery that would be like columns or yes, not directly, but yes, very much so. There's a lot of nostalgia. What always surprises me, because I don't think of myself as being nostalgic, but when I see the work, there's a lot of that going on. And I thought it was funny that after the World Trade, which is really, you know, that is a very modern, you know, I live downtown. When I lived downtown, I lived downtown, mostly upstate, about four blocks from the World Trade Center. And actually, I used to see the World Trade Center through my skylight when you go through the door. That's how close it was. So it was very funny that I went to this sleepy southern town, and I just thought, you know, reconstruction. That's what that town is about. That's what right now my life was about. And it felt like a kind of healing thing to do. It was also a slow process. It wasn't so. There were these sweet molds with the plaster. There was laying lath in these sort of old-fashioned methods of making a dome. There was doing a lot of sort of research on a lot of the imagery and in the houses around there. So it was a kind of walk down a memory lane, which is sort of funny that it was just about sort of making something out of nothing or rebuilding.
You're talking about your preparatory drawings?
They're not preparatory. They can come anywhere in the process.
They're not so much about planning the pieces, about like meandering
around. Yeah, they're trying to 30 of those kinds of things, and I didn't know what I was, they were spilling. I'd just come back from Yucatan, and then I was doing a show with Polly Solomon, I didn't show the material, but it was like, my God, that's what that was, you know, so they were preparatory without knowing what I was preparing, you know, and I think we all do that. So when you read through your old notes and you think, I knew that then, I said that then, it's just coming, you know, I'm just hearing it now. Yes.
I'm curious about size. Was that something that in the 70s you felt you had to do in order to?
No, I've always, when I came, I was married when I was very young. And my husband would come home and, you know, I'd taken over, I'd start building stuff there. And this was not when I was like an artist, in fact. Al Held got me into Yale because he thought the paint, I don't think he liked the paintings. He liked the box the paintings came in. And also they were huge. 12 feet by 8 feet. That's a huge painting. And they were, you had to give, he also thought it was nice that I didn't roll them up because he knew they wouldn't be able to, they wouldn't survive because they were sort of, so, no, it's always been big. That we agreed on that. Both like very big. I think it's because it was like an experience. And if you walk into something, it's an experience. If you can isolate it, It's different. It's like going in the garden, you know, it's like, you know, I mean, yeah, you can look down and you can see that that's this rose or that this thing, but it's really like you